Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great goodness. As a father is tender towards his children, so is the Lord tender towards those that fear him. For he knows of what we are made. He remembers that we are but dust.
Questi giorni quando vieni il bel sole, la 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 la. On days like these when skies are blue and fields are green, I look around and think about what might have been. And then I hear sweet music float around my head as I recall the many things we left unsaid. It's on days like these that I remember singing songs and drinking wine while your eyes play games with mine. On days like these I wonder what became of you. Maybe today you're singing
songs. Brother Bob was born in Forest Gate Maternity Hospital on the 26th of July 1955. He was the eldest of five children. Bob was taken home to 12 Palmerston Road, the two up and one down in Forest Gate, where he lived with Mum, Dad, Nan and Grandad, Dad's sister, her Aunt June, and her husband Bill, and their three children, Billy, Lorraine and Terry, our cousins. Mum, Dad, Aunt June and Uncle Bill, it was only 10 years since the war had ended. Mum, Dad, Aunt June and Uncle Bill were doing their bit to help boost the population. Next to being born was our sister Tina, followed by our cousin Cheryl, then our sister Angela, and then me. Finally, Bob had a little brother. Then after me, our cousin Jacqueline was born. The year I was born, the family was saddened by the death of our granddad. He passed away on Bob's sixth birthday. With five adults and nine grandchildren, the house was becoming rather crowded. It was 1965. Mum and Dad were given a three-bedroom council flat in Grange Road, Plaistow, number 366. Bob and our cousin Terry were always together when growing up in Forest Gate. Tina asked Terry if he had any stories. Terry sent me this email. What can I say about Bob? To me, he was always little Bobby. He was my first cousin and my first friend. We was together a whole lot, like brothers growing up. We lived together, nine kids in one house. We grew up together, went scrumping, got chased out of gardens. We had a spaceship for years. Long story, but I got a car when I was 12 from an old guy who lived up the road, Gil. Then I said to Bob, jump in, and off we went to Stratford from Forest Gate, a 12-year-old and a 10-year-old. On the way back, pulling into our road, the police spotted us and we got pulled over, and that was that. The keys got taken and Bob's dad, Uncle Bob, got the car. It was a Ford Popular, 1954. I was devastated in 1965. Bob, Tina, Angie and Roddy, Gerald was not born at the time, all moved from Forest Gate to Grange Road, Plaistow. When I wanted to see Bob and the family, I used to skate from Forest Gate to Plaster every week, there and back, come rain or shine. Me and Bob would climb the drain pipes that were all over the back of the buildings and cause a bit of havoc. I must say, we was happy kids. There are many more stories. I could tell much more about me and Bob, but I'll stop here as I might implicate ourselves for criminal charges. I will miss him madly, as we all will. Anyone who met Bob loved him. He left us far too early, but he was wanted where we all eventually meet up. All I can say, it must be important why he was needed so soon. We will be seeing you, Bob, always in our hearts and minds, Terry. Thank you, Terry. My memories are when we lived in Grange Road. I was about 6 years old. Our sisters Tina and Angela shared a bedroom and both had their own beds. Me and Bob shared the smallest bedroom and started off sharing a single bed. When we went to bed at night, Bob would get his torch and we would get under the blankets. Sometimes Bob would read a comic. It was always Commando or the Victor. Or we would pretend we was in a submarine, a tank or a Lancaster bomber and go off on some dangerous mission during the war. The only danger being was when Dad came in and told us to be quiet and go to sleep. Mission aborted. Mum went into hospital to give birth to our brother Gerald. So Nan came to stay for a week to look after the family. Bob had to sleep with Dad and I had to share our bed with Nan. Boy, was we glad when Mum and Gerald came home from hospital. I remember I was about 7. If Bob wasn't out with his mates, he would be indoors building airfix models or reading books and comics about the war. Most kids my age were taken to the pictures by their older brothers and sisters to see films like Snow White, Dumbo, or whatever Disney film was out at the time. I remember Bob took me to the pictures 3 times, and each time it was to see a war film. The Battle of Britain, Tora, 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 and a 1,000 bomb raid. I didn't care, I was with my big brother. It was no surprise when Bob was old enough, he and some of his friends joined a local army cadet unit. That was Bob's first introduction to the Royal Green Jackets. When Bob left school, his first job was an apprentice mechanic working on lorries at a firm called Foden's in Barkingside. Bob was in his early 20s when he got married and he was blessed with 2 children, his son David and daughter Helen, and later blessed with 3 grandchildren, Charlie, Alex and Harvey, Helen's 3 children. Here are some of Helen's memories. Dad was working as a chauffeur. He once picked me and David up from school in a Ferrari, and on more than one occasion, a limo or a Bentley. I remember someone asking me, "Are you rich?" I was on cloud 9. When Dad was in the TA, his beloved Royal Green Jackets, I remember many evenings spent in the bar in the mess hall in Stratford. On occasion, me and David would serve behind the bar with the aid of a crate, so I could stand on to see over the bar. I remember playing Status Quo's We're in the Army Now on repeat from the jukebox. One of the most significant memories from this time was when Ray Oram brought his Rottweiler Sally to the hall. David was holding her lead at one end of the hall and Ray stood at the other. A simple whistle from Ray and Sally bolted across the hall. David hit the deck and was dragged the full length of the hall. Dad was shouting, "Let go of the lead." David refused and so was pulled at speed by the dog until he reached Ray. David stood up and his once white jumper was black. Sally was adopted by us for a short while after that and she has a whole different set of memories and stories. On another occasion, we were at Dave Van Aert's pub in Elsham or Aylesbury. I can never remember. Everyone had quite a lot to drink and we were playing pool. Dad challenged me to a game of pool. I'd not long moved into my first flat. I didn't have much and I was broke. At the time, Dad had a really posh microwave, one of the first ones that had a pizza button, a grill and a jacket potato button. Basically, it was a top of the range microwave. I can't remember if it was me or Dad who said, "If I win, I get to keep the microwave." Well, I beat him and I got the microwave. I never let him live it down. We slept in the pub that night. Dad slept on one of the benches with a duvet over him. In the morning, I made egg and bacon sandwiches. Dad told me off for not breaking the yolk. I was therefore responsible for the yolk dripping down Dad's tin and onto the duvet. Once he had finished his sandwich, I remember looking over at him, still lying on the duvet, still lying on the bench with the duvet over him, with several straws all joined together, leading to a pint of Stella that was on the floor. That was resourceful. At one point in my life, Dad always belonged to a club of some sort. Obviously, he was a loyal member of the Royal British Legion, but previous to that, there was the Royal Naval Association, the Conservative Club, East End Workings Club, and various others, until he found the Royal British Legion. I think that they all had all one thing in common. They all had a bar. Bob joined the Territorial Army in 1982 and served with the Royal Green Jackets for nearly 10 years. He joined the Royal British Legion in 2006 and was an active member of the East End branch, organising the Poppy Pills and the Remembrance Day parades with his two best friends, Gary and Kenny. These were very happy times for Bob. Over the years, Bob had many interests. He was a keen sportsman and played football for the Pitshead Pub. He liked to draw and paint. He built scale models of all kinds of military vehicles and aircraft. He loved listening to music and reading. Bob had an appetite for knowledge. He had done calligraphy courses and an Open University degree in classical music and English literature. Bob did have his serious side, but he could never resist the opportunity to have a laugh with friends and loved ones given after chance. Paul Bowler, a regular at the Millerswell pub, a friend of Bob's, recently told me and our brother Gerard about the time he was knocked off his bike. At the time, Bob was working for the co-op Undertakers. He had just finished work and had gone straight to the Millerswell, still in his funeral attire. Paul was coming up the barking road on his push bike when a car doing a U-turn knocked him off his bike. Bob and a few others went out to see what happened. When Bob saw Paul on the floor, he took out a tape measure and started to measure him up for a coffin. That was typical Bob's sense of humour. We all have memories of Bob, and because of those memories, Bob lives on. So I'll finish by saying, God bless you, Bob. Thanks for the memories. Rest in peace.
Thank you very much. I think you deserve a big round of applause. That was really good.
My mate, Bob. I never thought I'd be standing here talking about such a special person. A true gentleman, someone who was there for you no matter what, and who loved nothing more than spending time with his family and friends, who he was fiercely protected of. He was one of the greatest mates you could have ever wished for, and life won't be the same without him. I know all of us have our own memories of Bob that will always make us smile. I first met Bob in 1982. It wasn't long when he joined the TA. It wasn't long before we realised that Bob was such a great bloke, and he became a fully signed up member of the 4RGJ family. I remember in 1984, when we were on exercise with the Yanks, we had an 8-mile fitness test in full kit. A quarter of a mile in, and the Yanks gave up. So we picked up all their kit and carried it along with our own. About a quarter of a mile from the end, there was this Yank who came running past shouting, "I'm going to win." But in a slightly different language, Bob did no less than chase after him. And you've got to remember, he had a great big machine gun and a rifle weighing about 30-odd pounds, plus two sets of kit. I've never seen him run so fast. And he leapt this fence, and I thought it was Colin Jackson, the Olympic hurdler. And he threatened to use the yank as target practice if he could get hold of him. Thankfully, he calmed down before we had the live shoot. And we had live ammo. Bob's jokes were legendary amongst us all, as was his sense of humour. A favourite memory was a group night out on a Chinese restaurant boat in Camden. Bob was on top form that night. The jokes rolled off his tongue, one after the other, until we could barely move for laughing. Only Bob could get away with telling a 10-minute long joke about a Chinese man and have all the Chinese waiters and waitresses laughing too. And on the way back, when we got outside Ray Oram's house to be dropped off, we tried to give the coach driver a tip, but he refused, begging us to request him next time we all went out. He was always at the end of the phone, our very own international rescue, as we used to call him. He could fix a car by blowing up a screwdriver, fix boilers with ease, telling Helen and Babs not to worry about the bits left over. He took my boiler to pieces and he put it all back and there was a load of bits left. And he said, there's always extra parts in there. And then Bob and I joined the RBL in 2006. The laughs and memories making continued. Over to Ken. Thanks, Gil.
I've known Bob for quite some time now. We first met at the West End Supporters Club. Him and Gary came down to join the RBL. He said to me, I can't make every Tuesday, as I work at East End Workmen's Club, and we also have a quiz night once a month on a Tuesday. So I said to him, well, when will you be there? He said, hopefully now and again. We all three seemed to hit it off straight away, and that was the start of a very special friendship, of which we later was called the Three Amigos. If you hadn't known. There was a bit of banter to and from the three of us, but a couple of things that came to mind was when we was at Weymouth. A plan came that we would exchange Brian's hackle. Now, people in the army don't know what a hackle is. Brian, the second one longer in standard, that's a hackle in his bearing. Now, Brian had a white one. We exchanged it for pink feathers. which the look on Brian's face when he saw the feathers was a picture. Brian said we wouldn't do it again. Well, that should never have said that. The next few years we did. There was one particular year we exchanged Brian's hackle for a duster. And Bob was holding his sides laughing when Simon came up and said, what regiment is that? The second was we had finished the parade. We had gone back to the pub, Black Dog. Wow, yeah. And that started from Bob as well. When we was down the Black Dog, that was Bob. Wow. We were all having a drink when all of a sudden Steve Warren suddenly got up and off he went. He gave Bob the sign to come to him, which was that, and off they went, pepper potting down the road. The pepper potting is one going in front of the other, covering each other. Down the high street with their make-believe rifles in their hands. That was so funny, everyone was looking at them wondering what was going on. And I remember Bob coming back and saying to me, I was knackered. I won't say what he actually did say. We used to go to Whitstable each year for the day to the RBL club. And after a while, most would go out to have a walk around the shops or go to the harbour for seafood. Myself and Bob, and sometimes Gary, if he wasn't on holiday, would go on tour. We would come out of the club, cross the road to the pub, have a couple of drinks, come out, and Bob would say, that's it, back to the club, so we went home. That was his tour. Occasionally we would venture to the butchers for sausages. There were all kinds of different flavours. And Bob did like a spicy sausage. And a little bit more than that. When Bob had an accident at work, he called myself and Gary to help him to get his car home and help him to the hospital. Well, I can tell you, we had the doctors and the nurses laughing at what me and Gary were getting onto. At one point, the doctor was looking in Bob's ear with the light, and me and Gary were standing next to him making signs on the wall and said to Bob,
The light goes straight through. Well, I can tell you what Bob said, but I dare say there's women here. There was a few choice words. He also told us where to go. Bob, unfortunately, had another accident after a day at Whitstable. I got a phone call from the ambulance driver telling me he had had a fall and he was okay, but would be going to hospital for a check, a checkup. And before I could say anything, I heard Bob in the background say, "Don't let them two boops down the hospital." Bob was also a big part of the East Ham Royal Beach Legion and took a very active role at our branch. He was a popular organiser, which he actually loved doing that and was very proud. And we also organised the Jack Cornwall Parade and Remembrance Day Parade. Excuse me. I lost one of my very special friends. I will miss you, Bob. God bless. Thank you.
Very clearly, we are saying goodbye to a much loved person, a very good man, a reliable man, a son of Newham, a thoroughly British English gentleman. Let us now pray our prayer of committal, asking God to have mercy upon our brother and friend, Robert. We have entrusted our brother Robert to God's mercy, and we now commit his body to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our frail bodies, that they may be transformed, conformed to his glorious body, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Go forth upon your journey from this world, O Christian soul. In the name of the Father who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ who suffered death for you and redeemed you, in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthens you, in communion with the blessed souls and aided by the angels and archangels, may the heavenly hosts welcome you. May your portion this day be in peace in your dwelling place, the New Jerusalem. Amen.
They shall grow old as we have left to grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
May God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.